There's a federal investigation into the law enforcement community that denied and delayed her justice. And the DOJ, via the U.S. Attorney's Office, has promised additional actions in the near future. In the national discussion, Ms. Cooper is often asked, along with Marcus Arbery, they're often asked if they feel like justice is being served for their family, or at least are we on the right path to justice? And the answer is an emphatic no. The family of Ahmaud Arbery cannot claim to be receiving justice when they have to squeeze droplets of justice from what appears to be a dry well. Mm. When the justice that they long for, as Dr. King says, it doesn't come rolling down like mighty water. Instead, we get trickles of justice, and they have to sit back and idly by and compete for pressure with the families of Breonna Taylor and the families of George Floyd and the families of so many others who have been denied justice systematically by a system that it has proven either incompetent or unwilling to provide justice to the Black community. We need a national response. Ben Crump and I, Chris Stewart, Daryl Washington, other civil rights attorneys around the country, we can no longer do this on a case-by-case basis. We cannot call and galvanize the community and demand that they focus their energy on one incident of injustice when we know that there are over, on average, 1,000 police officer-involved shootings a year, that we live in the most incarcerated nation on planet Earth, and that in the process of maintaining that system of mass incarceration, we empower our law enforcement officers to go in and brutalize and focus and over-police Black and brown communities. We are taking these families in a representative form for the thousands of families over the years who have been brutalized, who have been marginalized, who voices have been muted by our criminal justice system. We are taking them to Capitol Hill, and we are demanding that our lawmakers and congressional decision makers craft legislation specifically designed to deal with the crisis. And I repeat, the crisis of lack of accountability and excessive force in American policing. In addition to this congressional action, we're asking grassroots organizers and community members from all over the country to come together in a task force as we begin to map out our own solutions. We will be asking for economic boycotts and sanctions in these communities where these atrocities continue to occur. We will be demanding from both our local leaders and our corporate investors and backers to take time to launch a measured and direct campaign in these communities where injustice persists. And lastly, we will be asking for the United Nations, the Human Rights Commission, to consider hearing the cases of Ahmaud Arbery, of Breonna Taylor, of George Floyd as well. With that said, I am going to pass this conversation over to my esteemed colleague, my mentor, my brother, Benjamin Crump.
Thank you so much, Lee. I'm honored to fight for justice along with you, my Omega brother, in so many cases that are heartbreaking. And let me say thank you to Van Jones, who, man, not only your voice, but your demeanor of how you represent us, not just as a commentator, not just as a lawyer, but as a man, a Black man. We are always grateful for you giving a voice to the voiceless.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
And to Jay-Z and Beyonce and Roc Nation, Meek Mill, everybody involved, Ms. Austin, this is so necessary that we have this action today, this direct action where we lay a predicate for the blueprint that needs to be laid to finally address this national pandemic. You know, we have been dealing, Lee, with the coronavirus pandemic, but we and communities of color, especially the African-American community, have been dealing with another pandemic for far too long. and that is the pandemic of racism and discrimination. It is this pandemic that has been highlighted now with these three horrific cases that are just unbelievable, because it draws with laser focus the danger of being Black in America. The fact that it is open season on our children and our loved ones by the people who are supposed to protect and serve us. When you think about Breonna Taylor, she was just sleeping while Black in the sanctity of her own apartment. And please listen to the 911 tapes that came out yesterday by her boyfriend, Kenny Walker. It is just heartbreaking. Just when you thought these cases couldn't be any more heartbreaking, then you hear the 911 call where he's saying, "Stay with me, Breonna, stay with me, Bree," as he's looking at her body riddled with bullets. And the fact that he believed, because these dangerous no-knock warrants are allowed to be executed in our communities — they don't do this in other communities — but unconstitutional, dangerous no-knock warrants caused this innocent Black woman to be killed in the sanctity of her own apartment while she was sleeping. And then Lee Ahmaud Arbery, as you stated, jogging while Black. You saw the video of this lynching. I mean, a modern day lynching van in 2020, not 1940, not 1950, 2020. But as Lee said, they did not arrest his killers for 10 weeks. There had to be great public outcry and a video that we saw to finally make them arrest his murderers. And then we come to George Floyd, who was just trying to breathe while Black. He asked, like Eric Garner, "Let me breathe. I can't breathe." He said it over and over again. And what is so incredibly horrific about this particular video is we see in vivid detail that the police, who are supposed to protect and serve him, offered him no humanity, even when being axed by lay people, the general public. There was a woman who purported to be EMT of sorts who said, "Just let me take his pulse because y'all are killing him." She asked that over 15 times during this 8-minute ordeal. People just saying, "Let him breathe." Is that too much to ask for Black America to be allowed to breathe? And so with Roc Nation's assistance, Lee and I have called this what this is. It is a pandemic that is a national pandemic. We can't just keep looking at it regionally, like in Georgia Van or Kentucky or Minnesota. This is a national pandemic that's affecting all African Americans. It is a state of emergency. I was tell you, if we don't address this in the next month or two, we will see another unjustifiable, unnecessary, senseless killing of another unarmed, non-threatening African-American at the hands of people who are police or pretend to be police. Mm-hmm. And so that's what we have to deal with. And so when we ask for congressional hearings, when we ask for a national task force of the community leaders, civil rights leaders, grassroots leaders, all coming together to have a task force that is organized and systematic in how we respond to not just the high profile shootings. Because Lee Merritt would tell you, Daryl Washington would tell you, Chris Stewart would tell you, all of these, Monique Preston, all these civil rights lawyers would tell you, for every Ahmaud Arbery, every Trayvon Martin. There are dozens, man, of calls that we get that never get covered by the news, but they need a response too.
That's right.
And so that's what we're here to do. And then, as I said over and over again, I have this book, Open Season, The Legalized Genocide of Colored People. And Lee, you know, we've talked about this, going back to the United Nations. We did it with Michael Brown, killing in Ferguson, and we made our case in Geneva, Switzerland. We need to take these three families as a representatives of all the other Black and Brown people who've been marginalized, disenfranchised, and then dehumanized in their deaths by police and quasi-police. And we need to make the case before the United Nations that this is a human rights violation.
Yes.
So wait their verdict for the world to see. And I thank you, Lee. I thank you, Van. I thank you, Jay-Z.
Listen, I am, if anybody wondered why would these three family members who are going through, or these three families are going through the worst situation they possibly could go through, all picked the same legal team, I think you can see why, because of the passion, because of the brilliance, because of the determination. We're gonna open this up now to people who, if they want to ask questions from the press, I wanna make sure I say this the right way. If you have a question, you can submit it via the Q&A button. At the bottom of your screen, you'll see a Q&A button. And you can type in your question, and please, if you would, type in the outlet that you're from as well. And then I will do my best in this new high-tech situation to share those questions with you. Let me just ask, Lee, you mentioned legislation. Can you describe some of the things that might be in legislation that you think would address some of these concerns?
The focus of any legislation will have to be on, first, a police accountability. We know that less than 1% of these cases are ever indicted. And we heard from the district attorney in Minnesota, in Minneapolis yesterday, who said that there wasn't yet enough evidence to indict. I don't know what kind of evidence he's expecting when you have the video of George Floyd being murdered from several different sources. But the issue there is that the standard is far too high. And the Attorney General Eric Holder said this himself, the standard is far too high for civil rights accountability for law enforcement officers. We need legislation that specifically goes after qualified immunity and the additional protections offered to law enforcement officers. Now, this is not a partisan issue. You had Rush Limbaugh state that the family of George Floyd needs justice, and he's joined by the ACLU in saying the same thing. But the legal apparatus has said the laws as they exist on the books make it difficult for them to pursue arrests. I believe that they can make arrests for Floyd today, but we want to make sure that the laws from a federal level, the number one, that these cases are no longer handled solely locally, but the federal government will be asked to come in each of these cases, or these states will be denied federal funds. And we can get into to the particulars of the bill, but this would have to be a bill that goes at the heart of two issues. The first is the accountability for law enforcement officers. And as redundant as this may seem, we have to have better trained officers. Part of the problem is that our officers are in fact trained to kill. They're trained to terminate the threat. They are not trained sufficiently in de-escalation. And when they say that they're behaving as a reasonable police officer, it's because their training tells them that deadly force in the face of the mundane is reasonable when it is not.
Let me move on. We now have three questions and more are coming in. Either of you, Henry Rosoff from PIX 11 in New York He says there's striking similarities to the Eric Garner case in New York City, with Mr. Floyd's killing having struck a nerve here and in many places, with the federal authorities taking years to look into the Garner incident and eventually deciding not to even take action. What steps are you taking to make sure there is a different outcome in this case? And do you think there will be a different outcome in this case?
I do think there will be a different outcome in this case, but let me say for the record that we are calling for Keith Ellison, the Minnesota Attorney General, to take over this case. Yesterday, when the district attorney said that there was not enough evidence, not enough probable cause to make an arrest based on what we saw on that video. And I just want to talk about George Floyd case for just a minute, because I really want people to understand how his family is feeling. They watched their brother, their father die while a police officer had his knee on his neck for over 8 minutes. And I always want to try to make people understand what we actually see, because sometimes they need to hear it again. It's not 1 minute, it's not 2 minutes, it's not 3 minutes, it's not 4 minutes, it's not 5 minutes, it's not 6 minutes, it's not 7 minutes, it is 8 minutes where he is begging for life, begging for breath. And so I want everybody to take their cell phone when they get a quiet moment to really reflect on this case, man, and put 8 minutes on the stopwatch.
Yes, sir.
And just think about if somebody had their knee on your neck, constricting your airway, and you're trying desperately to breathe, and you're asking them, take your knee off my neck, and they won't do it. And you keep struggling and struggling until you suffocate to death. Mm-hmm. Well, that is the tragic last minutes of George Floyd's life.
Lord have mercy.
And it is tragic, but more importantly, for the society in general who are looking to see if there's equal justice in America, it is murder. And so we are asking for you to continue to pray for the family, and we're asking you to join us in the demand that Minnesota Attorney General Keith Ellison takes over.
Yes,
because you're not arrested is like an insult to this family. And Vice President Biden spoke to this family, and he said what we all believe. They deserve justice because George Floyd was an American.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and a human being. Look, I want to just get through, the question just pouring in now, so I want to just try to get through as many as we can.
Man, let me say this. They asked the question, yes, we do feel we'll get justice, because this video, and I'm sure Legion believes this, everybody, is just even more horrific than even Eric Garner. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. Jamil Smith from Rolling Stone, two questions. Are there specific charges that you want to see filed against the officers once arrests are made? Should they be made? And what short-term measures have organizers and families prioritized to instigate needed police reform? What charges do you want?
I think the charges for the George Floyd family should be murder. And we should have felony murder for the other officers involved. We saw this play itself out in Ahmaud Arbery's case with the initial two arrests. There was a man recording the behavior of two men, and there was one shooter. But eventually, law enforcement got it right, and they charged the other two men with felony murder. Because when you conspire and you participate, and you and you're part of a group of people who commit a crime, you will be held responsible for the murder that takes place. And that's true in the Black community. That's true in any inner city. That if you become a part of a group that goes out and commits a crime and someone dies during the course of that crime, you can anticipate being charged with murder. That's the appropriate charge for not only the officer who kept his knee on the neck of George Floyd unrelentingly, but for the other officers who stood around, stopped people from intervening, who did not intervene themselves, and who were derelict on their duty, they are guilty of murder as well.
Well said. Tariq Minor from WJXT Television, Channel 4 News in Jacksonville. What specifically could the DA in Minnesota be referring to when he said he does not have enough evidence to arrest the officer who killed George Floyd? Is it perhaps something to do with Floyd's autopsy or health concerns? What do you think is going on there?
Well, I will announce that we've just spoken recently with the district attorney. We're going to take custody back of George Floyd's body, and we're bringing in Dr. Michael Bodden to perform an independent autopsy, because we saw in the Eric Garner case and so many other cases where they have these people who work with the city come up with things that are such an illusion about, you didn't know he had a heart condition, oh, he had asthma, all this stuff that is completely irrelevant, because they were living, breathing, walking just fine until the police accosted them and assaulted and battered them. And so we don't want to begin to speculate about what their narrative is, because we know the precedence in this case was a false narrative in that police report that first came out the night before the video was made apparent to everybody to see what happened. And so this false narrative, we know they said he was threatening them, he was violent, and that he died from just a medical condition, and never once said about the knee on his neck for 8 minutes. So the family does not trust anything coming from the Minneapolis Police Department. How can they? And that's why they're going to have their own autopsy. So we're not going to rely on this DA or this city to tell us the truth. We've already saw the truth. We're calling for Keith Ellison and the Attorney General of Minnesota office to take over.
I believe the governor would have to invite Keith Ellison to take over. He doesn't have statutory authority to do so, but he can be brought in by the governor. So
that's a great point, Van. And hopefully everybody who's listening to this can join in calling, demanding the governor to get this independent prosecutor on this case, because obviously yesterday, we don't think it's independent and we have no trust.
I want to make sure that Breonna Taylor is addressed as well. And we have a couple of questions about her case. She hasn't gotten as much attention. There was not video, but the horrific situation of being in your own home, violating no law, and to wake up to a hail of bullets, and for that to be considered somehow justified, I think should shock the conscience of the country just as much. Marvis Herring wants to know, even if the police department there eventually fires the three officers involved in the raid that killed Breonna Taylor, what else are you all hoping for as charges within that police department and other cities? And that's Marvis Herring from WLKY News in Louisville. What are you hoping for in terms of charges with Breonna Taylor?
I'll just say briefly, and then I'll let Lee respond. Attorney Lanita Baker, Attorney Sam Aguiar, and I are asking and demanding that they get rid of these dangerous, unconstitutional, no-knock warrants. I think they're very constitutionally vague, and we need to get rid of them. And it's interesting, Van, because we're joined in this by Senator Rand Paul from across the aisle, who said in the aftermath of Breonna Taylor's execution in her own apartment that these no-knock warrants should be abolished.
The definition for murder in almost all 50 states is to intentionally cause the death of another human being. The word intentional doesn't have to modify the act of murder, but that they intentionally pull the trigger. And we know that they did, because they didn't do it once or twice. They did it. They poured a volley of bullets into that woman's home, and they had no justification for it. That is murder. And so for the case of Breonna Taylor, we're asking for murder charges for all three officers involved. We're asking for murder charges, the same murder charges that were applied in the Ahmaud Arbery case and that are appropriate in the George Floyd case. And the district attorney in Floyd, not to be distracted, has more than enough evidence to arrest those officers today, to issue warrants for their arrest today. The district attorney and the investigators in Breonna Taylor case has more than enough evidence. And the community will continue to stand up and demand justice for Breonna Taylor the same way they did for Ahmaud Arbery. What we're saying today is that we are tired of making the same redundant demands, but we need systematic change from a federal level, from an international level, that ensures that this is the regular process, that without millions of people standing up and demanding justice and flooding phone lines and airways and calling the governor, as they should in Minneapolis, that a system will be put in place. And that's what we're calling for today, that a system will be put in place, that our community knows how to respond to each one of these incidents, and that the government has a specific way of overseeing, the federal government has a systematic way of overseeing local governments to ensure justice for victims of police brutality.
While we're on it, Lee, one last question on Breonna Taylor. There has not been video released, just audio. Will that change the way you all approach your case against the Louisville Metro Police Department? Again, that's another one from Marv's hearing in Louisville. Will not having a video, is that going to change your approach to the case?
And I will take this one. Absolutely not, because when you think of that, we have the 911 tape, we have independent witnesses, and we have objective evidence that they shot blindly because the trajectory of the bullets. The next door neighbor, a white family, a young 5-year-old little girl, had a bullet in her room. They were shooting so recklessly and blindly into this apartment. And so we think that they violated policies and procedures when they didn't identify themselves. They violated policies and procedures when they already had the subject they were searching for in custody. They violated policies and procedures by literally shooting into a home. And I know Lee know a little bit about this from Atiana Jefferson's case. You shoot into a home and you don't know what's in there. And so it's unacceptable. And we won't stop saying Breonna Taylor's name. We got to keep uplifting our sisters up too, just as much as we uplift our brothers.
Yes. And Van, if I can jump in just for a moment here, I appreciate you emphasizing the case of Breonna Taylor, because our sisters who are murdered by law enforcement and who are often, whose families are often denied justice, don't get the appropriate emphasis that they need, not only from the legal apparatus, but from our community. And so I'm so proud to stand with the family of Breonna Taylor and stand with the families of so many sisters murdered. In fact, there's a new organization that was just launched yesterday, Sisters of the Movement, led by the families of Tatiana Jefferson, led by the families of both Mjong and so many other sisters who suffer in silence, really, as their cases are marginalized. So I'm asking people to go join Sisters of the Movement and pay attention to their voices as well.
And let me say the name of Pamela Turner. Please go watch that video. Houston, Texas, one of the worst. She was on her back. The police officer was on his feet, shot 5 times at her. Officer Juan de la Cruz, and she was screaming, "I'm pregnant," and he still executed that sister. So we can't forget that. And Sisters of the Movement, we got to hold you up to look out for the sisters and hold everybody accountable for saying her name.
That's right. That's right. Look, we are near the end of our time. I'm going to, there are great questions here, and I apologize to everybody whose questions we're not going to be able to get to. There is another important question about the Department of Justice, and it comes from Troy Kless from First Coast News in Jacksonville, Florida. The DOJ is pursuing hate crimes charges in the Ahmaud Arbery case against the men charging his killing. What else could be done to ensure that these men are prosecuted at the state and federal level? Also, besides a hate crimes bill in Georgia, what other laws should change? So it's a compound question. Talk to us about the DOJ and what you want the federal Department of Justice to be doing in this case.
As we take these families to Capitol Hill, And we look for specific legislation to deal with the ongoing issues of brutality and lack of accountability. We will be relying heavily on the Department of Justice to use its authorities, to use its FBI, its local offices to investigate in Ahmaud Arbery's case, but in almost every other case. And there's so many nameless families that we cannot mention, the Jeffrey Dennis's and the Jamel Robersons and the heroes in our country whose families have still been denied justice. In each of those cases, we need an entity like the DOJ that is present not only in every state, but in every region in those states to go in and investigate. Mind you, it's not just the men and women who murder individuals and who aren't held accountable, but it's the system that protects them. It's the district attorney's office in the case of Ahmaud Arbery, the George Barnhill and the Jackie Johnsons who reviewed the video before it was public and did nothing, who buried it, who misled the public about the facts and the law, who denied their own ties and conflicts of interest. And we see that being exposed in Ahmaud Arbery's case, but it is present in Breonna Taylor's case. It is certainly present in George Floyd's case, and that's why we're asking for the governor to acknowledge an inherent conflict between district attorney's office in the law enforcement community. They rely too heavily on law enforcement to do their job. So when it's time to prosecute law enforcement officers, there's a natural and inherent and unavoidable bias. And that's why we believe that it's appropriate for, in each of these cases, for the DOJ to get involved, for the FBI to get involved, and so that you have an entity that's outside of the local legal apparatus that is responsible for thoroughly investigating and properly prosecuting the men who committed the crime and the system that continues to protect them.
Let me say quicker, because I know time is running. Mm-hmm. It really is about not just the laws on paper, because they're dead words. We need people to breathe laws in them, consent decrees, the economic justice that makes a city have to either pay the government or the federal government or lose funding when they find that you have a pattern, like in Minneapolis, you have a pattern. And until you get it right, we're gonna have economics play a role of making you understand the significance that all citizens deserve constitutional protections of not only the police, but of the city government as well.
Final question from Eric Ortiz with NBC News. Please share your thoughts, and this is a reflection question. Please share your thoughts on why you think these three cases have touched off national protests in a way we have not seen to this extent in several years. And do you believe there's a pent-up anger or frustration because of racial injustice, politics? Why is this now coming to a boil?
I'll let you go first.
I will be honest. I'll be honest with you, Van. I'll be honest with you, Ben. Me personally, I'm exhausted. I don't want another phone call from a family that says their loved one was murdered by a police officer, a phone call that I know is coming. In 2019, there was only 27 days in the entire calendar year where police didn't murder someone, where police didn't cause the death of another human being. Some of those cases, of course, are going to be instances of justifiable use of force, but every other modern nation in the world has figured out a way of policing its citizens without killing so many of them and without incarcerating so many of them. Every other modern world, there is no nation on planet Earth that kills and incarcerates so many of its citizens, period. That is a point that has been reiterated at this time with these back-to-back tragedies. And it's frustrating and it's exhausting. And the community is saying, we need to do something different. You know, the lawsuits are not going to be enough. Individual instances of justice will not be enough. We will not be pacified with, you know, things apparently going right in one or two cases. Because exceptionalism is not a solution. We need systematic solutions to these ongoing problems. And I want to say this, in case this is the last thing that I say, yeah. The people in Minneapolis and St. Paul are going to hear a lot of people cautioning them to be peaceful. And of course, we want you to be peaceful. We're going to have people caution them to be calm. And of course, we want calm, but not in the absence of justice. So we need, in response to the unrest, the civil unrest in the city of Minneapolis, in Louisville, Kentucky, and all over the country, the appropriate response is not to call them thugs, is not to label them and threaten them with bullets, but to guarantee them justice and to fight like hell to make sure that each one of these families get justice. That should be our response.
Attorney Crump.
Yes. Why these cases are representative of so many other cases where disenfranchised, marginalized people have been killed by police or pretend police is because they represent, fully illustrated, the current system we have now response when one of these murders take place. There's a false narrative, whether it's Ahmaud Arbery, whether it's Breonna Taylor, whether it is George Floyd, a false narrative put out there. And we have to dig and do exceptional things like our video or objective evidence to question the standard police narrative that they caused their own death or it was justified in the killing. And so when we look at these three cases, the video obviously are very graphic. The objective evidence is very graphic. But when you look at the humanity of each of these individuals, when you look at the humanity of Ahmaud just jogging, doing something that we all do every day, when we look at Breonna in our house, imagine sleeping in your bed at 12:30 and somebody busting through the door, and your boyfriend trying to do what he's been taught to do his whole life. You try to protect your family. You try to protect our women. And he does that. But the two justice systems that exist in America not only allows them to kill your love, but it also allows them to then falsely accuse and incarcerate you and have you facing life in prison for just trying to say self-defense. That Black people have a right to the Second Amendment too. We have a right to, you know, out defend our castles. And then thirdly, with George Floyd, I still go back to the fact that you had the public trying to de-escalate this situation and the police who were trained to de-escalate was trained with conflict, confrontation analysis, escalating the situation. And it underscores why, as Congresswoman Maxine Waters and I discussed, the chokehold back to Chief Daryl Gates, Van, you there in Los Angeles, mm-hmm. all the way to Eric Gardner, now to George Floyd. We can't have net compressions and restrictions as a way to detain people, especially people of color. And so these are just graphic representations of what others have suffered in each and every case of people who have been killed by the police. These are just representative of it. And so this gives us an opportunity, now that the whole world is watching, that the whole world is emotional, because we know as trial lawyers, man, when people are emotional, they act. And so we want you to continue to look at Ahmaud Arbery video. We want you to continue to listen to Breonna Taylor 911 tape, to hear her boyfriend saying, somebody broke in our apartment. Help us, please, help us, please. They shot my girlfriend. Stay with me, Bree, just stay with me. And to look at George Floyd's video, because when you look at it, if you are human, you will be emotional. And we pray that emotion will get you to act, to do something that is systematic, that is methodical, that is deliberate, to respond each and every time when they kill another unarmed Black, brown person in this country unjustifiably.
I want to thank you on behalf of the country for what you're doing. It is critical we look at this as an opportunity to end this reign of terror. This is terrorism. This is what terrorism is. When no matter what you do, you cannot be guaranteed safety or justice. And so I also just want to point out that the incredible restraint of the African-American community in the face of these endless provocations is never applauded or recognized appropriately. When somebody, you know, throws a brick and we don't know who's throwing these bricks, that is commented on. But no people's patience is without limit. That's how you got the Boston Tea Party. At a certain point, any people being provoked is going to want a justified response from the system, or then things move in a different direction. And so the system is on trial here. That's right. The system itself is on trial here.
That's right.
If this is not enough evidence for prosecutions, what evidence can possibly be made available? It's incontrovertible that this sister was just in her bed. It's incontrovertible that this man was begging for his life for 7 minutes in broad daylight. It's incontrovertible that Ahmaud was unarmed. These are not controversial facts. And if this evidence is not enough, if this level of legal counsel and brilliance is not enough, if this level of global public outrage, black and white, is not enough, then you have to explain to us what is enough. Because at some point, enough is enough. And we've had enough. So thank you very much. I will especially appreciate Roc Nation. They're going to get mad at me for saying this, but I'm going to say it anyway. Jay-Z and all the people he works with, from Desiree Perez to Meek Mill to Mike Rubin, there's a whole bunch of people in the Roc Nation family who very quietly do a lot of good for our community. People can't wait to jump on a Jay-Z for this thing or that thing. But we are blessed to have people in high positions with big power coming to the aid and rescue of folks in low positions with little power, but with humanity on their side and a need for justice. I am proud to be a part of the Roc Nation family. They don't like it when I say this. They want to move undercover. I'm not blowing nobody's cover, but I'm saying when you see this conference call pulled together, understand a lot is happening behind the scenes. And I appreciate Roc Nation. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Roc Nation, and everyone involved.